educators. Thank you for listening to Classroom Conversations, the platform for Georgia's teachers. We've positioned this platform as a place where you can share and learn to enrich your classroom instruction. And we've got two dynamo departments to thank for that, the Georgia Department of Education and Georgia Public Broadcasting. I'm Ashleigh Mingwasser, the talker around here. You've heard the phrase, talk is cheap, but for teachers, talk is invaluable. You've also heard this phrase uttered annoyedly. Quit talking in circles, meaning the speaker is not advancing their point. But what if I told you talking in circles is a methodology teachers can use to advance their point? What am I even talking about? Let's talk it out. Picture this: dialogue circles, talking in a circle, in a circle, in a circle, in a circle. In one Georgia classroom, the teacher of the year for Bulloch County is an excellent case study for the instructional benefit of dialogue circles, and she's doing it the right way. Ashleigh Wright is a 19-year educator teaching 10th grade government and AP government at Southeast Bulloch High School in Brooklet, Georgia. It's rare but special when I get to host another Ashleigh, so this is already going to be good. But wait until you hear Ashleigh Wright's energy. There is no better person to bring us this creative, unexpected topic. Welcome to the show, Ashleigh.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here.
Your earrings are on fire today. I always warn my guests not to leave your hoops at home, because sometimes the headphones can crush your skull if you've got big earrings on. But tell us about your beautiful dangles today.
Yes. Well, when you said that, I thought, wow, I don't know if I can do that. I'm kind of known at my school for my big, crazy earrings, especially with Christmas coming up now. I've been wearing all my different. I even have some nice glittery leg lamps.
Oh, wow.
And Santas and trees and all sorts of things. But I thought, nope, I got to wear my big earrings for today. I have a whole wall in my closet for my earrings.
These are red and they're dangly and they give me a little bit of a 70s vibe, maybe.
Yes, absolutely.
I appreciate that.
You got to go with the red shoes. You know,
there's red shoes? Mm-hmm. Let me pause to appreciate those. 10 out of 10 in matching. Matching skills on fleek. I have not heard of Brooklet, Georgia before. What's it like in Brooklet?
Oh, goodness. Brooklet is a small little country town in the middle. Our school is right in the middle of peanut and cotton fields.
Wow.
We have a cotton gin right there in Brooklet. You can always tell when it's time. Right now, actually, they've been harvesting the last few weeks, and you'll see the big bells out in the fields, and it looks like that's the only time we get anything that looks like snow all the way down the road to the cotton gin. You see the cotton all down the sides of the road where it's fallen off the trucks, and that's about the only time it looks like snow down there. But it's just outside of Statesboro, right down the road, not even a red light, so less than a one red light town.
Right.
We do have a caution light.
Okay. That's as close as you get to snow is cotton fibers.
Yes,
that's so
right.
Very Georgia of you. Did you talk your way into teaching, you dialoguer? I know you are. How did you come by this career?
Oh, goodness. So my mom was a teacher. She actually taught me in the fourth grade. I think she kind of always suspected maybe I would go into education. That wasn't my original plan. But when I was in college, that kind of changed. And I decided to go into teaching and haven't looked back. Here
you
I
haven't
am
looked back.
3 degrees later from Georgia Southern, and go Eagles. And 19 years later.
How long was your mom a teacher?
46 years, 30 years with elementary, and then 16 years with teaching early childhood at the technical college.
Major claps for that. And we have to give the matriarch her due. She is here in the control room today cheering you on. Her imprint is clearly visible. But she told you, you said that you'd make a great teacher, and you originally were like, I'm not doing that, because your family had another business growing up that you thought you might be involved with. Tell me about that.
We had a flower shop, and that's what I always wanted to do. I would take flowers like out of the trash can that they were throwing away, you know, and make corsages and make arrangements. And that's what I thought I would do. I was going to go get a business degree and come back and do that. And plans changed. But kind of interestingly enough, early on in teaching, a co-teacher in my room, we got to talking. I met her that year, and she has a wedding floral business. And so I started helping her out a little bit. And so I still get to do that.
Just been helping out.
Yes.
But your primary gig is as a high school teacher. What do you like most about teaching high schoolers?
Oh, high schoolers are so fun. Teenagers are unpredictable.
Yes.
You never know what you're going to get. No 2 days or 2 classes or 2 hours are the same. Everything's always different. You have to be real flexible with them. But they also are, they're very authentic. They will be real with you. They know when you're not being real with them.
Yes.
And they're not very tolerant of that. So you really get to be yourself, bring your own personality, even if they think it's quirky or
they'll respect
nerdy
it,
nerdy or whatever it is. They still respect that because it's authentic.
It's not phony.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, let's keep talking about your personal life. You had me at floral design. you've got two kids and a husband. Tell
yes.
me a bit about them.
Yes. Yeah. So I've been married to my husband, Alan, for, oh, goodness.
Don't listen to this, Alan.
I know I'm going to get this wrong. 19 years, the same amount of time I've been teaching. So
wow.
19 years now, we have a daughter, Brooks, who is a sixth grader, and then Shelby Lou, who is a kindergartner now.
So you've got two coming your way into high school eventually.
Yes, yes. They'll be right there at my high school. So.
Do you think that will be exciting teaching them or a little bit odd?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
I think so. My mom taught me, so we'll see. Although she would not let me call her mom, like I had to call her Miss Brooks, like she was serious business. She would not call on me until the very end, but I better know the answer. If we forgot the homework, she wouldn't tell us, like we had to call a friend because she said nobody else lived with the teacher.
That's the truth. That's
she wouldn't
fair.
Help us with our homework. Our dad had to help us. Like if you left something at school, she was like, not everybody has a key to the school. Nope, we're not going back. She would make us pay her $1 to go back and get something from
that
school.
That sounds fair and balanced.
Yeah,
I'm completely on board with this.
She's pretty strict.
And you have two kids, but you've actually touched many children's lives in your lifetime. Tell me about that.
Yeah, so between my daughters are almost 7 years apart between those two. And when my oldest was two, we decided to explore foster care and foster parenting. And so we went through that training and for several years, we hosted, we were lucky enough to have five kids in our home, not all
wow.
at the same time. yes. And so we were able anywhere from, we had them anywhere from maybe 4 months to 18 months living with us and as part of our family. And we have been very lucky that almost all of them, four of them, we're still in contact with.
Oh, wow.
With either the family they went back to or their adoptive families. And so we're able to see them. Just a couple weeks ago at a football game in town, I saw some of the our first two that
wow.
we had when they were, goodness, 4 and 1. And they're in 4th and 7th grade now. So crazy. But it has been such a blessing. The most difficult thing I've ever done, but the most rewarding.
What does fostering mean to you? Why do you think it was so rewarding?
Oh, goodness. I think it's just an opportunity to really give back to the community and also to really touch not just children, but their family. When I first went into it, you know, most of my thoughts were about the children and, that we would have and, you know, how to go about parenting them and helping them and impacting their lives. But what I found was we got to build such good relationships with their families, too, particularly one family. And they ended up going back home with that family. And we're still friends to this day. And we were able to form such a great relationship with their parents.
Right.
And really able just to see a whole family's life turn around.
That's an incredible story. Did you see the 2018 film Instant Family, the comedy?
Yes, so great.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
Everybody should watch that if they haven't. But it really highlights just kind of the unexpected benefit that you get if you foster.
Yes.
And then it also just the comedy of errors.
Oh, absolutely.
Is near constant.
Yes.
Did you ever have any moments like that in your house? Did anything explode?
Oh, goodness.
Anything like that?
nothing exploded, no. Nothing too crazy, I don't think.
That's good. You had things under control. Like
yes.
a good teacher, Ashleigh.
Yes.
Cakes and flowers. You have this creative bent within you. I have to know, what is the instrument used to ice cakes called? I've wondered about that.
Oh, goodness. Well, there's lots of different ones. It kind of depends on what you're doing. Most of mine was with, I did with buttercream. So you have all different kinds of spatulas, and then you have all different kinds of icing tips that you use to make, to make all different designs and shapes and things like that.
Are there any best practices for cakes that we should know about, baking or decorating? What did you learn in your time?
Oh, my goodness. Definitely attention to detail, I think. In doing that, one of my favorite my youngest, this is my oldest daughter, when she was two, we had a storybook birthday party, and So I did one, and I wanted to include all these different books and things, and it was so much fun. I had the pokey little puppy on there, and I had the cookie from If You Give a Mouse a Cookie, and the yellow hat from Curious George, and Corduroy's Buttons, and just all these different fun Dr. Seuss's hat, and all these fun little things.
So for you, it sounds like vision. It's to have a vision for the cake.
Yes.
How do you even get into cake decorating?
That's a great question. I really don't know. My middle sister, she feels like she's much older than me because she's much wiser than I am. She's only about 20 months older than me. But she, one day we were talking and she was like, hey, you know, I think this is something that you could do. You should look into cake decorating. I'm like, really? And so I looked, and our technical college had a class, and I was like, I'll try it out. So I took that class, and I learned a few things there, but then just kind of started doing kids' birthdays, and yeah, I had so much fun. I did that for several years until we started fostering, actually, and then the time for that kind of went out the window.
you just fly with the spark of an idea, which I love so much about you. And I know your floral design skills came from working with a family business. Some. Do you have a favorite flower you like to arrange?
Probably peonies.
Yes. They're so beautiful. Yes. That's your favorite? Do you have a second favorite?
Ranunculus, maybe?
Me too. That's my favorite. Yeah. Good old buttercup. Yeah. Maybe we should talk about today's subject now, because we could talk about flowers all day. But I want to discuss your creativity in the classroom. Thank you. Which makes for good dialogue. You've been so creative with your 10th grade government and AP government students. Mainly what I think we know about good dialogue is that it should be a conversation, not a monologue, right? So tell us, what are some things that make for good dialogue? What are some factors?
Yeah, I think definitely is attention, which is one thing one thing I like about dialogue circles is it kind of forces, at least for me, teenagers, to really pay attention to each other and listen. Those listening skills, that's not usually their strong suit. They're all about texting and snapping each other, but those listening skills and being able to really not just be thinking, you know, while someone's talking, you're not just formulating your response. You're really listening. And seeking to understand what they're saying,
right,
and their perspective and their point of view. So I think really being engaged and attentive and then listening to what the
dialogue
other
is about, listening first. That's a really good point. And not just listening to respond, listening to understand.
Yes.
Those are some good takeaways. What are dialogue circles?
Yeah.
Well, let's just get right into it and how you use them.
Yeah. So for high school teachers, I think sometimes it can be kind of intimidating, or we don't really know what that is. You know, you see elementary, you know, my kindergartner, if I said, all right, you know, let's come to the circle, everybody come get in the circle on the carpet, they would jump right
in. They know what to do.
But middle and high school students and teachers, not so much. We're like, we're not really sure about that. So dialogue circles for me kind of started a couple of years ago. We had RISA training that my school was doing, and we talked about this idea of circles, and it was really intriguing to me. It's really a way, I mean, it's just what it sounds like. Everybody gets in a circle, either sitting, standing, however you want to do that. In high school classrooms, at least for me, generally standing works best. We don't, you know, we usually have a little more traditional classrooms probably than an elementary school teacher, but we all face each other. We have a little talking piece. In my class, that's a little Sunshine Aldi dog toy, because that's what I found at the time, and it seemed to work. And we go through, it's just really a discussion method that makes sure everyone is engaged, everyone's involved, no one can hide. You know, a lot of times in classroom discussions, especially in high school, you know, you're going to have those who are always talking and you're always hearing from, but you're also going to have those who
hang back,
really try to fade into the background. And in a circle, there's no background, you know, there's not really anywhere to hide. And so that can be a little intimidating for students and teachers sometimes at the start. So I always like to start with things that they're comfortable sharing. You know, the beginning of a semester, beginning of a school year, when I'm getting to know the students, I'll start with things simple, you know, what's your favorite Starbucks drink? What's your Chick-fil-A order? whatever it may be, something that anybody would feel comfortable
good
sharing.
Icebreakers.
Yeah. And so then as we kind of, they get used to that idea of, okay, I can share in this circle. It's fine. You know, this isn't too intimidating. As we start to learn one another more, then we can take that into discussions about the content, about self-reflection, about reflection on the class, all sorts of things.
Isn't it funny how the circle is the go-to shape for these sorts of things, even in support groups?
Yes.
If somebody said, okay, everybody, form a square, form a triangle, that people would short circuit.
Yes.
They would not know what to do. So there is something open and accountable about the circle.
Yes.
And I think you said it. You have to look at everybody in the eye. You can't really hide.
That's right.
And there have to be some benefits to that. What are the benefits that you've seen from dialogue circles?
Yeah. So I think that a lot of times one of the biggest benefits is especially as high school student teachers, sometimes we are really guilty of doing most of the talking, and our students hear from us a lot. But sometimes hearing from each other is even better. They get a different perspective, even if we're just reviewing a topic, if we're reviewing some content, and they've heard me explain it, they've heard my explanation, but hearing it in a different way from their peers is sometimes so beneficial. And then even for that person who is doing the talking, seeing kind of the impact that somebody really understands what they're saying and that they're able to explain it in a way that makes sense really kind of cements the learning for themselves, but also kind of gives them some ownership in the classroom, and they see the benefit of kind of a larger learning community.
Yes. Can this practice be used in other schools as well, elementary, middle?
Oh, absolutely. I'm sure elementary teachers, you know, they do everything already.
They are living it up in
elementary. Yes. I mean, they exhaust me just thinking about it. but yes, middle and high school, I mean, like I said, it's for me, when we first went through this training, this was kind of an easy implementation for me. I tend to be pretty open with my students anyway. I teach government, which lends itself to a lot of open discussion and dialogue anyway. And I really have tried to be real reflective with myself, kind of modeling that to my students, and with my students helping them self-reflect on their progress and their learning. And so this was an easy kind of implementation for me, but for some other teachers, it was not. This is, I mean, it is giving up some control.
I mean,
you don't know what they're about to say.
Yeah.
And you're going to, you know.
It's passing the sun
right,
dog toy.
You're passing it on and, you know, letting them have their turn. But I think that's so empowering for the students.
Mm-hmm.
And so you get a lot of benefits, and you see students who don't normally participate, who start participating. They really start listening to each other, even with things. I mean, we've had some where I have a class where maybe things aren't going so well. Maybe I have a few behavior issues in there. And we can talk about, you know, we might start with a few kind of easy little questions. And I might say, okay, what's one thing you think is going really well, you know, so far in this class? And everybody can share. And then maybe what's a pet peeve you have?
Mm.
Or maybe what's something that's getting in the way of your learning? And it's amazing. You know, I can tell you all day long that if you quit trying to sneak your phone, you'd probably learn more. Or, that your behavior over here, it's not just hurting you, you're distracting other people. I can say that all day long. But when you hear your peers say, oh, you know, it really makes me struggle when I can't focus because somebody's trying to be the class clown.
Oh, or, yeah.
You know, so it's so much more impactful coming from other students.
From them. It's
yes.
So grounding. We know that middle school and high school students are more reluctant to share and talk among their peers, mm-hmm. as you've told us. How are you able to build trust with them so that they will share and go there with you?
Yeah, I think one way is by modeling. I've always been just real self-reflective of my own teaching, of my own class. So I'll ask them or I'll share with them, you know, if maybe, let's say, we had a quiz or a test and it didn't go so well, you know, for the majority of the class, we'll talk about it. And I'll say, okay, here are some things that I noticed that I think I need to do differently or that I think I need to do better. Do you agree? Do you see those same things? What are some things maybe that you do in other classes that you've had with other teachers or some strategies that work really well for you that maybe I can incorporate? And so I think by me being open and transparent with them.
And asking
then,
for feedback.
Yes, and asking for that feedback and being willing to take that constructive kind of criticism, that it helps them to be more open as well.
More fluid themselves.
Yes.
Are these dialogue circles planned topically, or do you do them impromptu?
Both. Absolutely.
Really?
Yes. So typically, like I said, at the beginning of a semester with a new group of students, I definitely plan in some with some specific kind of icebreakers, get to know you things, some things to kind of build that classroom culture. And then throughout the semester, throughout the course, I'll intentionally plan some to maybe discuss certain topics or to review content in certain ways. But then we also have some impromptu ones as well, depending on what's happening in the classroom. We may be learning about something and I feel like it really needs, you know, some more discussion than what I'm getting. And I might say, all right, let's take a break and have a circle. And so I might even start with like a kind of would you rather question just to kind of get them thinking and then go into some content. Or sometimes when you have, you know, that you have those, your lesson, you know, you're kind of at the end, don't really have time to start something new. You got like those 5 minutes. It's a great time to have a circle. Let's have a circle.
Yes.
And everybody share, you know, what's the most important thing that you learned, you know, today or whatever it may be.
Have you ever used these to solve an issue in your classroom?
Yeah, absolutely.
Can you give me an example?
Yes, a few times. One, like I mentioned earlier, I had, you know, a class where I felt like some students were really struggling with other students' behavior. And by opening up and asking them, okay, tell me what's something, you know, in this class that's helping your learning, and then what's something that's maybe impeding your learning a little bit. And having the students hear from each other, like, you know, without calling out names, saying, hey, you know, when people do this, this, and this, you know, it kind of makes me struggle a little bit more. And then also other times where I've even had kind of smaller dialogue circles outside of the classroom. So I had a group of students a couple of years ago who they were good friends. They were kind of always picking on each other, but in that, you know, fun, playful way, until one person, you know, till it's not fun and playful anymore.
And it hurt feelings.
Yep. And so I decided, you know, we need to chat about this. And so after class, I was able to grab my parapros in that class with me, who was awesome, an assistant principal and about 4 students in that class. We were able to go to a conference room, have a little circle. Everybody could kind of share what, you know, they were feeling, and all of them kind of admitted that they were getting their feelings hurt, even though they were all a part of it. They were
right.
All participating. I think they all felt like they were the only ones who were getting their feelings hurt. And so it was a really good way for them to all kind of see.
Oh, you too?
Yeah. Like, oh, maybe we are taking this too far. And then we could also say, okay, what are we going to do going forward? What's our plan? You know, how are we going to, is there something we can do? You know, if it's going too far, what can you say? What can you do to let them know this isn't the day for it, or, you know, I've had too much.
Yeah. So you're using this tool for relationship building.
Yeah.
You're using it for problem solving and classroom management. Can you give me an example where you've used your circles positively to talk about something content related? What's a good government question they have discussed in a circle?
Oh, yeah. Government's full of them. I mean, anything from, is the death penalty, is that cruel and unusual punishment?
Whoa.
Under the Eighth Amendment, does that count? What do you think? Do we need to put term limits on Congress? And if we do, how are we going to go about doing that when they're not real likely to propose an amendment themselves to do that? You know, how can we get around that? All sorts of things like that.
Is it about coming to consensus, or is it more about honoring the individual perspectives around the circle? What
yeah,
happens?
Definitely. You're never going to get to consensus. I think politics is a great example of showing us that.
Right.
Never going to come to consensus usually. But it's really, you know, about, honoring the different perspectives and really listening. A lot of times, even if you disagree with that other person, you may not have thought about something in the way that they see it. And so just hearing their perspective about, you know, the death penalty or whatever it may be, even if it doesn't change your mind or change your perspective, it still just broadens your understanding of the topic. And it also helps you to be, you know, more empathetic to those different perspectives.
Multiple
out
perspectives.
There.
Yeah. Are these tailor-made? Can this be a 5 or 10 minute tool and a full class length tool? Have you ever used them at different lengths?
Absolutely. Yeah? Sometimes it's only 3 or 4 minutes. And sometimes I think it's only going to be 3 or 4 minutes and it turns into longer. Sometimes, you know, I would say probably 30 minutes is as long as I've had one go, but it definitely could, depending on your students and the discussion.
But I hear you saying that dialogue is just so rich and so beneficial that it's worth it.
Oh, absolutely.
It's worth the time. What important aspects of dialogue circles should be considered by teachers in terms of implementation?
Yeah, absolutely.
Time would be one piece.
Yeah, definitely time. Definitely kind of thinking out ahead of time what that's going to look like in your class. I have round tables. I know a lot of, you know, that's different for a lot of high school teachers. They would not like that. but a lot of them, you know, have straight rows and desks, whatever that is. What's that going to look like? Are we going to, in my class, we can pull our chairs out and sit in a circle. Are we going to stand, you know, around? We even have some teachers in our school who go and do them in the hallway. We even have some who take them outside. Let's, you know, go outside. The kids always love that. Even teenagers, they still like to go outside. You know, go right outside the classroom and have a circle in the fresh air. So thinking through logistically, how's that going to work?
I wonder if people think it's a seance if they drive by. Like, wow, what are those students
doing?
Yeah,
probably so. And then generally, even though maybe in the beginning it feels maybe a little hokey, but some kind of talking piece of some sort, just to kind of give that visual of, oh, it's not my turn. You know, like I said, mine was as simple as looking through the Aldi Instacart aisles and adding a dog toy that I saw to my Instacart shopping list when I decided to start. Yeah, it's like a big sunshine.
That's perfect.
Yeah, it is perfect. And so anyway, that's what we use. So definitely coming up with that. And then when you introduce it to students, doing so in a way that makes them not feel intimidated, kind of willing to share in the beginning, and also kind of laying some ground rules, you know, that we speak one at a time, that our discussions stay in this classroom, that we're going to respect each other, even if we disagree with each other, you know, and that we're really going to listen with that intent to understand.
Those agreements have to be in place first.
Yes.
Yeah. What tips would you give a teacher beginning dialogue circles in their classroom? Are there a couple of go-to questions they can start with?
Yeah, I think just to not overthink it to start with and pick something easy and short to start with. Just something where everybody, depending on the grade level, depending on what kids, you know, what your kids are into, it might be what's your favorite Taylor Swift song. It might be, you know, your Starbucks order. It might be, what'd you eat for breakfast this morning? It, you know, just something that you think your kids are going to be willing to share, something that maybe everybody's going to have a little bit of a different answer with. You know,
right.
You don't want to hear the same thing, you know, 28 times. so something that definitely has a lot of possible answers. And then go from there. You know, even I have a little deck of like, would you rather cards.
Those are
and
fun.
Sometimes you can pull one of those out and, you know, here you go. Would you rather, whatever it may be, and let them share, you know, what they think.
So it's really not much mental load on the educator. It's really about just posing the question and let the fruitful work unfold. Take note, watch everybody come together. It sounds like this has really been working for you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely. I would also say for teachers, if you are intimidated, if you have multiple, you know, classes like in middle or high school, like pick your, you know, pick maybe your safest class. I won't say best, but, you know, pick that class that you can see this working the best in and start there. And then once you're comfortable, you know, then you can branch out to other. You don't have to jump all in.
Expand.
You don't have to jump in the deep end to start with.
Right.
Yes.
I hope that dialogue circles take over the world after this, Ashleigh. Thank you so much. You are a high demand dialoguer. We appreciate you sharing your conversational skills.
Thank you so much.
This has been a wonderful conversation. Now it's time to talk turkey, teachers. Dialogue circles are the move, straight talk. It's not about talking heads or talking big, about talking jive or talking through one's hat, about talking to hear one's own voice. No, it's about the give and take of talking true, listening, responding. To conclude this episode, I'll talk from the heart with this pep talk. You're a great teacher. I'm Ashleigh. Join our circle next week for more teacher talk on Classroom Conversations. I'll stop talking now. Goodbye. Funding for Classroom Conversations is made possible through the School Climate Transformation Grant.